Ever since the dawn of time, man has told tales of heroes, from biblical accounts of David and Samson, to the epic poems of Homer that invigorated Greek culture and inspired generals such as Alexander the Great. Then, like now, we took as our heroes individuals who were strong in body and in mind, capable of kindness and compassion, but also capable of fighting for justice. Throughout the history of cinema, movie heroes have come in all shapes and sizes, from six-gun-toting cowboys to police detectives. But in 1959, a new hero arose. Steve Reeves, 6'1", incredibly handsome, and bringing to the silver screen for the first time the body of a god. 215 pounds of Mr. Universe muscle, power, and grace. Moviegoers everywhere were riveted by his animal magnetism. They had just seen an ideal of a man as he can and ought to be for the first time. Absolute physical and moral perfection. And the world of cinema would never be the same again. He was born Stephen Lester Reeves in Glasgow, Montana, on January 21, 1926, the only child of Golden and Lester Reeves. Reeves' father, Lester, passed away when the boy was 18 months old as a result of a freak farming accident, which left Steve's early upbringing solely in the hands of his mother. The boy seemed destined for fame in the world of health and fitness, winning the Healthiest Baby in the County Award at the tender age of 6 months. Always an active child, by the time Steve Reeves was old enough to enter high school, he had discovered bodybuilding. In the early 1940s, bodybuilding was looked down upon by the general public. Athletes were actively discouraged to lift weights, believing that it would make them muscle-bound. Reeves, however, liked what he saw. The images of John Grimmick and other bodybuilders from that era served to inspire him, and he began to work out in the garage of the family home, using a simple barbell set and writing out his workout routine in crayon on the garage wall.
When I first started training, I used to look at pictures of different bodybuilders, and there was no one bodybuilder that I thought, well, I want to be like him. For instance, I would choose, I would look at John Grimmick, and I'd say, you know, I'd like to have legs like that. Now, there's a good pair of legs. He has calves and thighs and balance on legs like Grimmick's. Then I look at people say, like Alan Steffen, I say, now there is a great pair of lats. Now there is a great back. And maybe a definition like Clarence Ross. So I was just making a composite of these different bodybuilders, putting them all together, and working that way.
Not long afterward, Reeves joined a bodybuilding gymnasium and came under the tutelage of the legendary Oakland gym owner, Ed Yerrick. Working with the raw material of the greatest genetics the world of bodybuilding has ever seen, within a mere 4 months, Reeves had gained over 30 pounds of muscle.
So every pound of muscle I put on was good muscle all the way up. When I first started, I was 16 and a half years old, and I weighed 163. Okay, I worked out for a month, and I went on the scale. I was looking a little better, more firmed up, more in shape. I still weighed 163. But that month was kind of toned the body up, get my metabolism working well for me. And then the following month, I went on the scale, and I weighed 173. I get 10 pounds of solid muscle. You can see it growing in a month. The following month, I get another 10 pounds of solid muscle. The following month, another 10 pounds of solid muscle. So it was after working out with weights for 4 months, I was the best built guy at the gym. The guys would work out 3 or 4 years, they couldn't believe it.
It was while in Oakland that the Reeves philosophy began to materialize. He would not only strive to live a balanced life, but to build a balanced physique. He had no interest in building muscular size merely for the sake of size. Proportion and shape would be his primary goals, and he achieved them through dedicated, purposeful training.
To be in shape and to be fit is a great thing, but I don't think it should
dominate and rule your life. It should be just one of the aspects of your life. I would naturally recommend a person who would have the symmetrical, classic type physique, because I believe that's more desirable to the general public.
So when I started working out, my arms were 13 and a half, and my calves were 16 and a half. So there are 3 inches of proportion right there. So I didn't work my calves at all until I got my arms to 16 and a half, and then I built my arms, had my neck and my calves up to 17 together, 17 and a half together, 18 together, 18 and a quarter together, and I left them there. That was funny for me. By the way, I think for an athlete, the ideal weight would be according to height. We'll say we'll start at a person 6 foot tall, we'll put 200 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you progress each inch over 6 foot, add 15 pounds. 6'1", 250, 6'2", 30, 6, et cetera. And under 6 feet, you just drop 10 pounds. Like a person will say is 5'11", 190. And even for bodybuilders, I think that would be great. It worked for me. I was 6'1 and 215, and it seemed ideal for me.
So ideal, in fact, that he was encouraged to compete, many believing that he would have been a shoo-in to win the coveted Mr. America title. But the bodybuilding laurels would have to wait. The Second World War had begun. Upon Reeves' graduation from Castle Mount High School in 1944, the war was at its height, and on a clear, calm morning of September 12, 1944, Steve Reeves reported to the Presidio of Monterey, California, for induction into the Army. Soldiers were being shipped overseas quickly, and Reeves was no exception. After 6 short weeks of basic training, he received orders to ship out to the Philippines. Reeves belonged to Company A of the 25th Division, which was involved in some of the bloodiest action of the war. He was decorated with the Combat Infantryman's Badge and several other awards for his valor under fire.
Then when I got to the 25th Division, we were on the front lines, and we fought the Battle of Lady Pass. And it could have been devastating if I had the wrong mentality. But when I went in there as if I was watching a motion picture. So in other words, I was kind of the observer. I would see people being killed. I would see people being carried out on stretchers. In fact, we were walking into the front lines. You'd see people being carried out on stretchers with a leg missing, the leg would fall off the stretcher, they'd throw the leg back on. Or a guy had been gut shot, and his intestines were hanging, dragging on the ground, but taking him out there. I mean, that could have been devastating for a guy just turned 19, you know, going in the service to the front lines.
Not long afterward, Reeves contracted a severe case of malaria, which required a long period of hospitalization, during which time he could not work out, resulting in a body weight loss of over 30 pounds. After several more occurrences of malaria, Reeves was transferred from combat duty to the Quartermaster Corps and was soon assigned to Japan during the Allied occupation. He was stationed on Nokkaido Island, eventually ending up in Tokyo with General MacArthur's troops. Reeves was still physically below par, and he knew he had to do something to get himself back in shape. He sought out a Japanese interpreter, and the two tracked down a local foundry, where, with the aid of sketches and a lot of gesturing, Reeves had a 210-pound barbell set manufactured. It didn't take long, despite the crude equipment, for Reeves to build his strength and physique back up. He kept his weights under his bed in the barracks, then built an exercise bench, which passed Army inspections because it looked enough like an ironing board to fool the inspecting officers. So impressive was his strength and physique that soon his fellow soldiers were referring to him as the Shape, and his superior officers requested that he start training the troops to increase their strength and fitness levels. With the ending of the Second World War, Reeves cast his gaze homeward, and upon beginning a career that would make him a legend in the world of bodybuilding. On September 18, 1946, Reeves found himself standing once again on good old American terra firma. He had now been discharged from the service and almost immediately back at Ed Yarick's gym in Oakland. This time, however, he was no longer Yarick's pupil. He was now his equal and was soon to eclipse not only his former mentor, but every other bodybuilder in the world. A mere 3 months after his return, in December of 1946, Reeves entered his first bodybuilding contest, the Mr. Pacific Coast, held that year in Portland, Oregon. His physique, with its tremendous blend of shape, symmetry, and size, blew away the competition, and he was awarded the title. Fueled by this success, Reeves dug in and trained even harder. He entered and won his second contest, the Mr. Western America title, in Los Angeles, California. However, these two titles were merely grist for the mill of the ambitious young Reeves, stepping stones to the most coveted title in bodybuilding, the Mr. America. The Mr. America contest was to be held a mere 3 weeks later, June 29, 1947, in Chicago, Illinois. One of Reeves' main competitors, legendary bodybuilder George Eiferman, recalled how the word of Reeves was getting out and unnerving some of his competitors.
No one in the Midwest had seen him. A few days before the contest, we heard rumors about a man that had throngs of people following him along the Lake Michigan beachfront, and we could not imagine who could draw crowds by merely walking along a beach. I was anxious to see this man, and when we did, we knew he was the Mr. America for that year. George Eiferman, Mr. America contestant, 1947.
Unbeknownst to his fellow competitors, Reeves, in preparing for this, the most important contest of his career, was not only training hard physically, but also employing a form of psychology not commonly known in post-World War II America, and called the power of visualization, or positive visual imagery, which helped him to stay focused and motivated for the impending contest.
When I was training for the Mr. America contest, what I would do is this. I had a training partner, and more or less you do 10. I'd do 10 reps.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I'd do is he'd count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the 6th rep, he would name one of the competitors that was going to be in the Mr. America contest. See, I knew who they were, but they didn't know who I was, because
yeah.
I'd just throw my pictures in there until I was, you know, until after I won my contest. So what I would do is, we'll say, number 6, you might say, Eiferman. I go, boom. That means in my own mind, I beat Eiferman.
Yeah.
So the next one, you say 7. Instead of 7, you would say, Robotnik. I go, boom, for Robotnik. And you say 9 or 10 or whatever, you say, Eric Pedersen, boom. So I knew who the 5 guys I had to beat were that would inspire me. I was winning the contest before the contest existed, before I was actually on the stage. But I believe if you can't conceive an idea, you can't realize it, you know.
The word was now out in the bodybuilding world of a phenomenon that was moving in their midst. Reeves was sought after by the top physique photographers in the industry, including the legendary Tony Lanza of Montreal, whose photographs of the young Mr. America would set the standard for physique photography for the next 40 years. Despite shooting the best bodybuilders in the world throughout the course of his career, Lanza had never experienced anything like Steve Reeves. After the contest, and as they were walking around the Lake Michigan beachfront where the beaches hug the road, searching for a suitable location to shoot some photographs of the new champion, they suddenly heard a crash behind them. A man had driven his automobile into another car. He climbed out of the wreck, raced up to Reeves, and shook his hand, saying, "I just had an accident over there, and I had to come over and congratulate you, because you're the cause of it. I couldn't believe my eyes." The photos taken by Lanza that day would tend to support the poor driver's disbelief. Never before had the bodybuilding world seen such a complete package. However, the young Titan was in for a shock. Unlike today, there were no endorsements for bodybuilders in the 1940s, not even if they were Mr. America winners.
In fact, it was hard to make a living as a bodybuilder. That's why I went into being an actor.
As luck would have it, Reeves was approached by a New York agent and offered a chance to attend Stella Adler's renowned Method Acting School, a school that had turned out such superstars as Marlon Brando, Montgomery Clift, and Eli Wallach. Reeves didn't get along with Adler, however, as in his mind, she was looking to turn out leading men who slurred their speech, shuffled their feet, and did not represent what, in his estimation, a leading man should be: strong, articulate, and confident. He left Adler's school and entered the Theodore Irving School, performing on weekends with a comedian named Dick Burney, working theaters and small clubs in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and New York. At about this time, Reeves was approached by a new fan, Hollywood mogul Cecil B. DeMille. who had not only a special poster of Reeves commissioned and put up on his office wall in Universal Studios, but who wanted Reeves to star in his new biblical epic, Samson and Delilah. However, DeMille had a request. He wanted Reeves to lose muscle mass in order not to dwarf the other members of the cast. Reeves obliged and dropped 10 pounds, but in doing so, he felt that he wasn't being true to himself. He was, after all, a bodybuilder who had worked hard to create and reveal physical perfection. DeMille's offer, it seemed, was to become a star at the cost of his soul. Reeves considered the price too high. He built his body back up, and the role of Samson, the legendary biblical strongman, went to Victor Mature.
I went to Universal Studios and had an interview, and they told me, well, you're a good-looking guy, and you're tall and everything, but we can put you on the contract for like 20 Curtis or Rock Hudson. But the trouble is you had that physique, and we could only maybe use you in one picture a year, and that would be limited, so we can't sign you up for a contract. So it was actually a detriment at first. In fact, there were actors. There was Gregory Peck, who would not have me work with him in a film because he didn't want to be standing beside me. There was Gary Cooper, who didn't want me to be in a picture with him. Those are just two that I know of. And there was Whit Lancaster, who didn't want me to be in a picture with him. The three right there. But then, when those pictures came along where you had to have a good physique, it was a great advantage.
Reeves grew frustrated waiting for his big break to arrive and decided to return to his passion, bodybuilding. He set his sights on a new contest, the Mr. Universe, which was to be held 13 months later in London, England. The Mr. Universe was then considered to be the Super Bowl of bodybuilding, and Reeves' motivation was fueled by the fact that he would at long last be competing against the man whose photo had first inspired him to take up the sport, the legendary John Grimmick. Reeves' preparation was his hardest yet, and his reputation had proceeded into England. By the time of his arrival in London, thousands of bodybuilding fans had turned out to see his first appearance on European soil. The mob was so big, in fact, that Reeves had to check into not one, but two hotels to escape it, signing into the second under an assumed name to get some peace and quiet and to better focus on the battle to come. On the night of August 23rd, 1948, the judges decided that the contest was between Grimmick and Reeves, but was too close to call. They declared it a draw. But a means to break the tie was quickly determined by the judges, one of whom was Grimmick's patron, Bob Hoffman. It was decided that the best way to settle the physique contest was to have a gymnastics competition between the two finalists, with the Mr. Universe title being awarded to the better gymnast. I knew right then I had lost the title, Reeves would later recollect, for Grimmick was a gymnast par excellence. Grimmick pressed into a handstand, then walked over into a full splits, hit a double biceps pose, and was awarded the title of Mr. Universe 1948. Not that Reeves didn't have his share of supporters. British movie star Patricia Plunkett wanted her picture taken with Reeves, not Grimmick, while Frederick IX of Denmark approached Reeves and asked him to become his personal trainer. Reeves declined, and as he left the stage, he was told that the Mr. World contest was being held in France a mere 3 days later. Having come too far to return home empty-handed, Reeves decided to enter the competition. After taking a simple workout for the benefit of the paparazzi, Reeves was ready for action. He took to the posing dais like a tiger and hit pose after mind-boggling pose, causing the French judges, who had never seen a body of Reeves' caliber before and who had heard of Reeves chiefly by reputation, to be completely overwhelmed. And on August 26, 1948, they declared him not only Mr. World, but le plus bel athlete du monde. After the contest, Reeves wowed the Oceanside spectators at Cannes with an impromptu posing display before heading home to America to consider his future. Once back in America, Reeves took some much-needed time off. He found meaningful employment, but it wasn't long before his interest returned to the one title that had eluded him, Mr. Universe. There was only one problem, however. By the time that Reeves had made up his mind to enter the contest, it was only 4 weeks away. Reeves headed out to York, Pennsylvania, and trained at the famous York Barbell Club, the home of John Grimmick. Reeves trained with such ferocity and deep concentration that he amazed all who were present by his quick transformation.
I didn't give myself any limitations. I didn't know it was difficult to build muscles.
no one told me, well, that's really hard to do. You have to work for years before you can gain an inch on your arm and things like that. I had no limitations, and I used extreme concentration. In other words, when I'd work out, I would concentrate on the muscle at work. Concentrate on the movements, doing them nice and slow. It's like I could feel the movement on the way up, all the way up, all the way down. There's full range of motion, and it really worked out well for me. Because what you have to do is you have to create a superior line of communication between your brain and your muscle. And you can only do that two ways, by concentration and by practicing muscle control in your spare time when you're not working. Because when you can flip those muscles, thing like that, that means you have great communication between your mind and your muscle tissue. So by building up a greater, superior line of communication between the brain and the muscles, I was able to develop much faster and easier. In other words, I didn't put so much time into it. I'd work out 3 days a week for about two and a half hours a day. Probably 2.5 hours, counting my body and my body. And the other 4 days a week, I would rest. The rest is just as important as working out.
Despite a brief bout of pneumonia, Reeves was big, ripped, and ready when he returned to London for the Mr. Universe contest, held at London's Scala Theatre on July 24, 1950. His chief competition that day was in the massively muscled form of young Reg Park, a man who would go on to star in several Hercules movies himself, and inspire another young bodybuilder into competition by the name of Arnold Schwarzenegger. After a close, hard-fought battle, Steve Reeves was awarded the Mr. Universe title. Reeves had now gone as high as he could go in bodybuilding. He announced his retirement from competition and made a new goal for himself, to become a movie star. Little did he know that it would be his incredible physique that would ultimately open the door for him to become the most famous actor in the world.
I didn't think of being a movie star or anything like their actor, but when I was about 20, I came down to the beach in Santa Monica, and people say, hey, are you a movie star? I said, no, I'm not. I'd go on the bus and say, are you a movie star? I say, no. But maybe I should be.
Reeves' acting career began humbly enough, on the stage, where he appeared in several Broadway productions, including Kismet and The Vamp with Carol Channing. Television also beckoned, and for the next 4 years, Reeves sustained himself by appearing on television programs such as Ozzie and Harriet, Topper, The Ralph Edwards Show, and Burns and Allen.
Mighty flabby body, Mr. Topper. Mighty flabby.
So I've been told. Constantly, for the last half hour.
Well, don't you worry. If anyone can fix you up, it's Joe Winnerke. You know what the muscle magazine said about my build?
I'm afraid I missed that issue.
That's okay. I brought a copy with me. There I am, right there.
So I gathered. And this is Jim.
Oh, I don't know her name. You know, you wouldn't have known me before I started building up my body. No, sir. You wouldn't have known me.
He was even approached to film a pilot episode for a potential Tarzan-esque television series entitled Kimbar of the Jungle, where he not only fought against evil men, but befriended the beasts of the jungle. However, television was changing, and the old 20-minute format was no longer applicable, and the producer did not have the budget to reshoot the pilot episode. So the pilot was never picked up, and Reeves found himself back among Hollywood's growing rank and file of unemployed actors. Things began to change for Reeves in 1953, when his agent secured him an audition for a supporting role as a detective in the film Jailbait, made by the infamous B-movie director Ed Wood.
There he was, Inspector. Right in our hands. We didn't get him.
And I think the doctor was only doing what he thought was right.
You gonna bring him in?
Well, perhaps later. He's not the type to run out. Have you found out anything more about where Brady is staying?
Yeah, he hasn't been back to his apartment in 3 days.
I got some men stationed around there. Others following up the new lead.
We liked my first film. That's where I got my Screen Actors Guild card. The film was, what was in production, was called The Hidden Face. And only later on, when they went to release it, they called it Jailbait because somebody came up with the idea that it would sell better. No, I liked working with Ed Wood. I thought he was a nice man, a good director, and he kind of let you do what you wanted and guided you slightly. He didn't dominate every move you made. My agent heard they were going to make the picture and thought, well, and read the script and thought, well, it'd be a good part for me to start with. In fact, in the whole picture, I think I had my shirt off for maybe 5 seconds.
Within a matter of weeks after completing Jailbait, Reeves was hired as a supporting player in the musical comedy Athena, a film that brought him and his physique to center stage and that showcased Reeves at what he did
Hello,
best,
girls.
Bodybuilding.
You're supposed to be with Grandpa, Ed. What are you doing here?
I just can't keep my mind on my workout. Athena, you've been avoiding me lately, and I'm off of acid and electricity.
Then you just tell Grandpa to give you a steam bath and stop thinking. It always affects you. If you're not Miss Universe, it'll just break Grandpa's heart. And I know you'll win, because you're the greatest and the best.
Why do you go around with Adam?
It's the stars. There's nothing I can do about it.
Your grandmother says the stars don't even like the way he lives.
I know. I'm going to have to do something about that.
Why bother? He's a worm. What kind of children would you have with a guy like that?
Well, if the stars say we should get married, I'm sure they'll take care of the children, too. Well, hi, Minerva.
Hi, Athena.
Johnny brought... Ed.
What?
You ate Minerva's orchid.
Orchid? I thought it tasted kind of funny.
It was a musical comedy. It had big stars like Jane Powell, Debbie Redmond, Vic Damone. And we didn't get a lot of exposure. And I was hoping it would be more successful than it was. I was hoping it would be another Seven Guys for Seven Brothers. I was pleased to do it, and I didn't have as much dialogue as I would have liked, but or as much exposure I would have liked. But that's where the game goes.
After shooting Athena, something more momentous happened in Reeves' life. While visiting Muscle Beach one afternoon, he noticed a pretty 17-year-old girl, Sandra Smith, who was lying on a large blanket with eight friends soaking up the warm California sun. One of the people on the blanket introduced the girl to the young aspiring actor. The two were married 6 months later, on January 31st, 1945. The marriage was to be short-lived, however, as Reeves was determined to make it in Hollywood, while Sandra wanted a settled home life. They divorced on September 4th, 1956, but remained close friends for the remainder of Reeves' life. Athena was released shortly after Reeves' divorce was finalized. And while the film did at a modest box office, Reeves quickly became the talk of Hollywood. More importantly, his performance in Athena had caught the attention of a young girl whose father was the Italian director Pietro Francisci. And as it happened, Francisci happened to be looking for an appropriate leading man to portray Hercules from a script he had written on the legendary labors of the immortal Greek and Roman mythological hero. She approached her father and said, "Daddy, I think I found your Hercules." On seeing Reeves' face and physique for himself, Francisci concurred with his daughter's assessment and sent Reeves a letter requesting his services as a leading man. Reeves didn't respond, believing the offer to be a joke. Francisci then followed up by sending him both a contract and a generous advance. Reeves signed the contract, flew to Italy, and prepared to star in Hercules, a movie that would change the landscape of cinematic history and make 31-year-old Steve Reeves the biggest name in motion pictures. The film would not be released in the United States until May of 1959, when it premiered at the Paramount Theater in Hollywood. 3 months later, it had become the biggest box office smash in Hollywood history. In its first week, it opened in 145 theaters and drew $900,000, the equivalent of at least $9 million today. In its second week, a total of 600 Eastman prints were ordered up, the largest single order that the processing lab had ever had. No one in the world had ever seen a body like Reeves displayed in this movie, and the climactic pulling down of the palace pillars at the end of the film revealed an unprecedented display of male muscularity. The American distributor of the film, impresario Joseph E. Levine, invested $1.2 million in advertising and promotion, and it paid off handsomely. At the end of its theatrical run, Hercules had earned Levine $14 million, the equivalent of over $140 million today. The summer of 1959 saw Reeves become the number one box office star in the world, and nobody was more surprised at this development than Steve Reeves.
I didn't have any idea that Hercules, my first starring role, would be the most successful picture in the whole world, not only the United States, but the whole world in 1959. I mean, I was top box office here. I know in Calcutta, India, it paid four showings a day, 365 days a year, for 2 years. And in Japan, it was a big in Japan, too, many, many places, but I had no idea.
Reeves would later reveal that he felt fated to play Hercules.
I must say, Hercules, I was fated to do Hercules, because when I was about 24 years old, I didn't have any money and things like that. But this artist, there was an artist in Redondo Beach, his name was Herbert Stowitz. And to a mutual friend, he asked if I would pose for the 12 Labors of Hercules. And for some reason I did it. I used to go over there every Thursday for about 3 hours in the evening and pose for the guy while he did the sketches. And so, I don't know, somebody just told me to do it. I don't know why I did it. I wasn't getting paid for it. I was burning my gas. I wasted my evening, I thought. But something told me I must do it. So I went over there and did it. And a couple years later, I was offered the role of Hercules. And so Hercules has been good to me, I guess, because I was good to him.
It didn't take long for other production companies to catch on. Soon the market was flooded with every type of Hercules picture one could think of. Even Reeves' fellow competitor from the 1950 Mr. Universe, Reg Park, ventured into the genre. Reeves' Hercules, however, was the first, and it outgrossed all 23 of the knockoff Hercules films that were to follow, including one starring Arnold Schwarzenegger and Lou Ferrigno. But the knockoffs lacked something that the original possessed, Steve Reeves. Hercules had been filmed in 1957, but was not released in America until 1959. After filming, Reeves had actually returned home to the United States, assuming that his 15 minutes of fame were over. He resumed work as a membership salesman for the American Health Studios, a chain of gymnasiums, and was beginning to think that this was as good as it was going to get for him. He hadn't been on the job 4 months, however, when he received word from his agent that his services were requested to star in a sequel to his first film, entitled Hercules Unchained. It was only when Reeves had signed on to do the sequel that he found out the extent of the success of his previous film, which was the biggest box office smash in European history. In the film, Reeves was able to match brawn with former heavyweight boxing champion Primo Carnera in one of the film's more intriguing fight scenes.
And no one passes through this valley unless I say so, and they pay a price. Yes, this valley is Antaeus's, and you do anything because I say so. Now tell me, do you have any gold hidden in the carriage? And the first thing I'll take are your horses, so unharness them for me.
Hercules! Hercules!
Oh, I want to sleep. Come on, you get down. I said I want the horses.
You take advantage of us just because you're Antaeus.
And why not? Just a boy and a lady. Come on now, get down.
I'll show you what a boy can do.
All right. There you are.
Hercules, you'll kill him.
I'm so sleepy I can't seem to keep awake.
Who are you speaking to?
To my husband.
And what's he doing?
He was dozing.
Dozing, was he? I'll wake him up. I know those sleepy husbands. Or is he just frightened?
He might awaken when he sees you.
Husband! Hey, you husband. That's right. Kiss your lady goodbye and pass on. I'm adopting the lady.
Is that right?
Yes, I'm taking her. That's my pleasure. I like her very much, the lady.
And what does she say about that?
She'd like a new husband like every woman.
Well, if that's the way it is.
But Hercules...
Didn't I tell you? They all turn out to be just like that. All right, come on, I'll be fine.
A pleasure. Maybe the next time you'll treat me better. Come on, let's be on our way. You've got a tough skin.
Hey!
Come on, Yuli.
He might be a god.
I don't care if he's Pluto. I'm going to knock that silly grin off his face once and for all.
I tell you, Hercules, it must be Antaeus, son of the Earth Goddess. When he touches the ground, he marshals his forces.
So that's it. Then I'll change my way of fighting.
Let me down, bro.
You just put me down and you'll see.
Let go of me, you cursed stranger. I'll get even with you by the gods. I said put me down. Let me down. One day you'll have to pass through my valley again.
No one ever.
It was in this film that Reeves also learned that some of his female co-stars were interested in romance off-screen as well as on.
The scene where I'm with Sylvia Lopez on that chaise or whatever it is, where all the slave girls are fanning me, a couple of girls are fanning me, a couple are giving me grapes, and she's sitting on there. Well, in that scene there, when she bends over and kisses me, she didn't take it as a screen kiss. She really kissed me, and she stayed there a long, long time. Apparently, she said, cut, stop, halt, stop, throw some water on them, stop. No. So surprisingly enough, I went home. I washed off my makeup, took a shower, had something to eat downstairs, and pretty soon the guy from down below said, the actress Sylvia Lopez is down here. She wants to see you. I thought, that scene must have went pretty good. So I said, send her up. So that was that.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
so in other words, what I thought was a screen kiss, she thought was something really real, so she said, well, I better go check this guy out.
Hercules Unchained also broke box office records, and there was pressure put on Reeves to film a third. Reeves, however, had other things on his mind. He had become enchanted by the charms of the beautiful Aline Kowalska, whom he had first met at a party during the last 2 weeks of filming Hercules. Kowalska had been employed by Embassy Pictures and by Joseph E. Levine to assist in the promotion of both Hercules and Hercules Unchained. When Reeves had returned to film Hercules Unchained, Aline and he were inseparable. Many considered their relationship doomed before it started. After all, Reeves was the epitome of physical culture. He didn't smoke, didn't drink, and was a world-class bodybuilder. Aline, by contrast, was a woman very much Reeves' opposite. She smoked, was proudly opinionated, and spoke no less than 6 languages. She even offered her services to help him negotiate the contract for his next film, The White Warrior, at no charge. Reeves had never experienced anyone like her in his life. He took her up on her offer of assistance, and the two began dating. When the director of Reeves' first 2 films learned that he had signed with a major competitor, he was furious.
Frenchie, she heard that I had gotten the contract to do The White Devil with a competitor of his called Ricardo Freda. And he said, don't go make the picture. He said, you're Hercules, he said. And besides, he said, without Franchishi, Steve is nothing. I said, well, we'll see. I thought to myself, we'll see.
And my destiny to fulfill. My destiny to fulfill.
Reeves had chosen as his next starring vehicle an adaptation of Leo Tolstoy's novel, Haji Murad. The film was shot in 1959 and was retitled The White Warrior, featuring Reeves portraying the early 19th century Islamic rebel leader of the tribes of the Caucasus Mountains, Haji Murad, who stubbornly and courageously fought against the imperialist conquests of Russia. As Murad wore white, he earned the name White Warrior.
whole Yugoslavian cavalry to ride behind me there in the White Warrior. For them getting the picture for Yugoslavia there, they built all the sets and they furnished the army. I did the jump on the piano. I didn't get on horse today, on the jump on the piano. I made sure the guy did it about three times so the horse knew exactly what he's going to do, the timing and all that. I didn't take any extra chances.
The film was a hit and firmly established that it was Reeves, not his directors, that made his films the success that they were. More offers were coming in daily, and so Reeves asked Aline to become his full-time agent. She accepted and immediately set to work raising his fee. And by the time the ink had dried on the contract for his next film, Goliath and the Barbarian, Steve Reeves' salary had jumped from $10,000 to $250,000 a picture.
You don't look like a woodcutter.
Appearances are deceiving.
Poor horse. He was a magnificent animal. Too bad you had to kill him. The life of a horse is precious.
And the lives of people?
What people? What are you trying to tell me?
This was a valley of peaceful, hardworking people. Then your forces invaded it, destroyed everything.
You hate us very much, don't you?
Why not? You've killed, you've plundered, you've burnt our towns.
You're no woodcutter. Who are you?
Ow!
The films harken back to Reeves' first two Hercules films in many respects, which did not disappoint his legions of fans who wanted to see Reeves and his great physique. Reeves would later recall,
I think the producer of Goliath and the Barbarians was a new producer just going into producing, and he wanted something that would be a sure thing. So after seeing the success of Hercules and Hercules Unchained in Europe, he thought, well, I'll make another picture of the same gender, but I won't call it Hercules, because other people had that name kind of tied up already in their scripts. So I think he utilized the popularity of Hercules to launch that film and its success.
Reeves' next film, also made in 1959, saw him as a Roman centurion named Glaucus, stationed in Pompeii during the catastrophic eruption of the volcano Vesuvius. The film was called The Last Days of Pompeii. However, an accident that occurred on the set of the film would reveal not only Reeves' character, but also lead to his early retirement. On the second last day of shooting, a team of horses pulling a chariot containing a female co-star broke away and began galloping toward a forest with their terrified passengers screaming for help. In a real-life feat of heroism, Reeves leapt onto a horse and galloped after the runaway chariot. Just as he caught up to the horses and grabbed hold of their reins to bring them under control, his focus shifted for a moment to the reins rather than the forest, and a branch from a large tree slammed into his shoulder, dislocating it. He forced it back into place by himself and finished the shooting for the day. The final scene of the movie had yet to be shot, however, which required his character to perform a 20-yard underwater swim beneath flaming oil that had been poured onto the surface of the water to simulate the fire and lava from an erupting volcano.
through that fire.
Not being able to surface and not being able to remain under the flaming liquid, Reeves was compelled to swim 60 feet underwater, and with each stroke, he was keenly aware that he was tearing ligaments in his injured shoulder. He finished the stunt, but his shoulder was irreparably damaged. Tensions arose when Reeves and director Sergio Leone, who would later become famous for directing Clint Eastwood in Fistful of Dollars, almost came to blows.
One scene where I was in the jail there and looking through the bars, and you can't just do something without a motive. You have to be motivated. You have to have some reason to do something. He said, because I told you so. And I almost broke down the set and grabbed him because, I mean, that's ridiculous. I mean, he has to tell me the reason why I have to do something, not because I tell you to. You know, how can you have the right expression on your face if you don't know what the hell you're thinking in your mind? So I wasn't really too happy to work with him anyway. Not that he did bad work, it's just that we didn't have a good rapport.
1960 ushered in a new slew of Steve Reeves films. Up first was The Giant of Marathon, in which Reeves portrayed the Greek hero Philippides. The film documented the early exploits of Greek athletic life and told of a heroic athlete who enlisted the aid of other groups of young athletes to use their strength and power to thwart a pending sea invasion by the Persian army during the historical Battle of Marathon. The film also showed the birth of the first Olympic Games.
To thee, divine Athena, to thee I consecrate the laurels of Olympia. As thou hast protected me, goddess, protect Athens, which bears thy name.
Reeves would later recall the famous underwater battle from the climax of the film.
I think it was filmed in about 3 days, and it was filmed in the real cool waters off of Capri there. There's always a concern for your safety, but what the productions always do is they always give you the most dangerous scene to be shot last on the last 3 days, whether it appears in the movie in the middle or at the end or at the beginning. So if something happens to you, they have the film wrapped up. You do what you can, then you could come up for air and you rest for a while and you go do another shot and back and forth. It's just part of your job.
Aline was still hard at work on behalf of her new boyfriend and client, but an offer came in from her former boss and Hercules distributor, Joseph Levine. Levine wanted another Hercules movie, but Aline convinced him not only that the market for Hercules films had been saturated, but also that the box office successes of Reeves' more recent outings had proven that a well-built leading man could play roles other than those of mythic strongmen. The hard-nosed Hollywood businessman yielded to her arguments and agreed to produce two more pictures starring Steve Reeves, the first of which was Morgan the Pirate, based upon the real-life exploits of the buccaneer Henry Morgan.
Welcome to the Isle of Tortuga!
Where do you come from?
I am Captain Morgan. These are my men.
They have captured a Spanish galleon and want to join you.
Oh, you want to join us? There's something you must know before that. Here, everybody takes orders from me, eh? Anything else?
I want these women. And I want you to give me supplies for my men. Incidentally, I always get what I'm after. Don't forget that. That's to remind you that my men only take orders from me.
Oh, you want to play games with me? Very well. I would pray if I were you, you will need all the help you can get.
That man is the English slave you bought.
Yes, I know.
The film reveals the rise of swashbuckling Henry Morgan from a bonded slave to an infamous pirate whose buccaneers plunder the Caribbean and plan a daring invasion of Panama. Problems soon arose, however, between Levine and his young star prior to the release of the film.
I say we had a good working relationship until the Zero came in. See, we had the contract for, I don't know which picture it was, maybe Morgan the Pirate, or maybe Keep of Baghdad, where my contract read that I got my name to be 70% of the title, 70% is larger of the title, and no other actor or producer or director or anybody else could get more than 50% of the title. But he wanted to have his to be as big as mine or bigger. And I said, no, Joe, you signed the contract, mine to be the first name above everybody else's, supposed to be 70% of the title. You can't put your name above mine and have it 70% or 80%. We have a contract. And this was in the Hotel Excelsior in Rome. He was eating a big bowl of spaghetti. He threw the spaghetti up. He was dripping from the chandeliers all down the place there. I mean, it was a mess. He got so mad because I wouldn't change the contract. Well, if he wanted the contract that way, he could have negotiated in the first place.
Still, with movies to be made and audiences clamoring for Steve Reeves, the two were able to put their differences aside long enough to film a remake of the famous fantasy classic, The Thief of Baghdad.
Its brilliance is only matched by your courage and your generosity.
Oh, it's beautiful.
In this film, Reeves plays a wily, lovable thief named Karim. It is an adventure tale straight out of the Arabian Nights. Karim steals from the oppressive rich and provides for the poor, while seeking to win the heart of a fair princess. There are battles with the Sultan's guard.
What's he doing? I order that! What's he doing? I want you to
I love you, princess.
Temptation in the form of beautiful women.
And the thief or
an
me?
An evil prince.
Arrest him! Take him!
Guardian of a bridge who wears a cloak of invisibility. and a flight on Pegasus, the flying horse, to search for a blue rose that would bring him the hand of his sweetheart in marriage.
Got him.
Got him. Got him.
My princess, there is only one power in the world that can bring happiness to those who've lost it, and that is love. If you love me, Amina, this is a blue rose.
Yes, Carrie. It's a blue rose.
The Boston Herald described the comedy as a constantly amusing film, which should please the whole family. By 1961, Reeves' interest in epics hadn't diminished, and so for his next picture, he took the subject matter of Homer's Iliad, depicting the treachery of Helen and the famous tactics of the Greek soldiers to penetrate the high walls of Troy in the year 1200 BC. The film was called The Trojan Horse.
I will add to the prize money two of the swiftest horses in the world. Is there no challenge?
The Greek warriors leave the honor to the Trojan, if he has the courage.
And Reeves would play Aeneas, friend of Hector, a valiant Trojan warrior who had died in battle with Achilles.
I will fight for one prize, for the arms of Hector. Is it the wish to have them as your own that drives you? I seek them only for Andromache, his wife.
You ask the finest prize I have won in 9 years of war, Aeneas. But I accept.
In honor of Patrocles, the Trojan Aeneas accepts the challenge for the glory of his race.
And Ajax for our own.
Come this way. At the signal, you will leap on the horseback and ride two circuits of the arena. The one who arrives first will have the advantage of using this, a glove. It is this advantage that could allow you to return to Troy alive. The hand-to-hand combat will be fought within the limits of this circle. The loser is the one who's thrown outside, or the one who remains inside, dead.
Take your places. Go!
Please, Ajax. Aeneas is running on the inside. Watch this.
Begin!
Reeves' next film was another historical drama entitled Duel of the Titans, which was an adaptation of Virgil's epic poem Aeneid and told the story of two brothers, Romulus and Remus, who fought to the death to create the foundations of the Roman Empire. Initially, the studio had wanted Reeves to play both brothers, but he insisted on casting his longtime friend Gordon Scott in the role of Remus, reigniting Scott's career in the process.
I've known Gordon since I was 20, he was 19. In Oakland, California there. Had no problem. I thought he was a nice guy and I recommended him for the part he wasn't doing at the time, and I thought, well, that would maybe relaunch his career, which he did.
Remus.
In 1962, Reeves was back in front of the cameras to film two more pictures. The first was a sequel to The Trojan Horse, which was called The Avenger, and saw his character of Aeneas defend the settlement of what would eventually become Rome. His second film in 1962 was another sequel of sorts. To capitalize on Kirk Douglas's box office smash Spartacus, the Italian production company Titanus decided to carry on that theme with The Slave, the Son of Spartacus. Set in Egypt during the Roman occupation, Reeves plays Randus, the champion of the slaves. The film is a record of how he attempts to avenge the death of his father Spartacus 20 years earlier and overthrow the tyrant Crassus.
Get rid of them forever, the whole bothersome lot!
Are you sure, Crassus? I mean, are you sure the man you fought against 25 years ago is not on your trail again? You know who I mean. Spartacus.
You're a raving man. Spartacus died on a cross and the dead never returned.
But his body was never found.
No, because the vultures ate it.
I've seen men killed in skirmishes. On their bodies, there was a sign like this. They say it's the sign of Spartacus.
In the summer of 1963, Reeves was offered the lead role in Sandokan, Emilio Salgari's novel about the Tiger of Malaysia, who fought against British imperialism and corruption. While a fictitious tale, it nevertheless won over the hearts of the Malaysian people, who related wholeheartedly with what Steve was portraying on the screen, packing one theater for an entire year, four showings a day, to see his portrayal of Sandokan.
The author of that, Emilio Salgari, he was the Jules Verne of Italy. And Sandokan is something that all school children in Italy read, and they admired him, because the Salgari was their Jules Verne. So the Italians thought it would be a big money maker and be good for Italy, and thought maybe the rest of the world would like it too. So that's why that was made. I thought the character was interesting, and I like wearing a turban.
In fact, so popular was his portrayal that the producers quickly inked him to star in a sequel entitled Pirates of the Seven Seas.
Oh,
Audiences around the world responded so favorably to the image of a heroic male with a truly heroic physique that it appeared there was no limit to the heights that Reeves' stardom would ascend. Whenever possible, the films Reeves selected to appear in were based upon actual historical events, works that had thrilled and inspired generations of human beings with their recounting of the deeds, accomplishments, and adventures of strong and noble men. Reeves, however, also enjoyed the opportunity to travel and experience the different cultures of the world.
Well, I liked that. That was one of the best parts about acting is the traveling. You got to go to all those countries, see the different cultures, taste the different food, check the different spectacular views of nature, architecture, and the mannerisms of the different people. How some people will say, like in Ceylon, when you ask him, are you going to be there at 9 o'clock to pick me up tomorrow morning to take me to the set? And the guy would say yes, and shake his head no at the same time. Things like that are very interesting.
By 1963, Reeves had been averaging 2 pictures a year, had traveled the world, and for tax purposes, had taken up residence in Switzerland with girlfriend manager Aline. He had also discovered that he had fallen deeply in love, and on June 24th, 1963, at the English Church of St. Mark's in Lucerne, Switzerland, he asked Aline to be his wife. Reeves settled into married life quite comfortably the second time around, so much so that he decided to retire at the very height of his popularity from motion pictures. He and Aline started building a home ranching business in 1964, purchasing land in Oregon to raise cattle. They would operate the enterprise until 1966, when the U.S. government notified him that they wished to purchase his property in order to build a reservoir. Over the next 2 years, while planning to rebuild his ranch, Reeves caught the acting bug one last time. Just as he had always wanted to win the Mr. Universe title before retiring from bodybuilding, he likewise had always wanted to make a Western before retiring from film.
One winter I read about 100 paperback Westerns because I wanted to do a Western. So I came across 3 I liked real well. So I contacted this literary agent in New York City and said, check into these 3, see if I can get an option to buy. So he checked into it, got back to me in a couple of weeks. He said, well, he said, 2 of them, Clint Walker has an option on, and the 3rd, John Wayne, has an option on. He said, but I understand that within a month, Clint Walker's going to take one of those and drop the other option. So I waited for a month, and luckily, out of all the 100 books I read and the 3 I picked out that I would do, he dropped the one that I wanted the most. It was called Judas Gun by Gordon Cherry Reeves.
The title would later be changed to A Long Ride from Hell, and Reeves would not only star in the film, but serve as its technical director, co-producer, and write the screenplay. In the film, Reeves' character is framed by a corrupt sheriff and sent to a brutal prison in Yuma. He breaks out and seeks revenge on the man who framed him.
You keep me...
With the completion of A Long Ride from Hell, the film career of Steve Reeves came to a close. After filming his last picture, the Reeves relocated to Valley Center, California, where they began laying the foundations for a new ranch. Retirement suited Reeves fine. He had always wanted to make a Western, and now he had. And after starring in 15 films, he and his wife were able to retire quite comfortably. Reeves had noted that other action stars, such as Tyrone Power and Earl Flynn, had both died before reaching the age of 50, and with his shoulder injury growing progressively worse, and realizing that he was now financially set for life, he decided to stop working for others and do the things he was passionate about, riding horses and keeping fit. In recalling his stellar career in films many years later, he offered this summation.
I thought I was an adequate actor for the parts I did. I never thought I was good, no. I never thought I was really bad, but I never thought I was good. And it's a funny thing. When I see my films now that were made 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago, I look at them and I think, hey, that film isn't so bad. Well, I'm not such a bad actor. At the time, I was super critical of myself, which kind of inhibited me. But now I look at them and say, hey, that wasn't bad at all. And it kind of left me.
For the remainder of his life, Steve Reeves continued to live his life the same way he always had, on his own terms, preferring quiet evenings at home with his wife to social gatherings and public appearances. Occasionally, he would appear at the opening of a gym of a friend, but his passion was breeding Morgan horses, which he rode every day, and for which he won dozens of ribbons at fairs and tournaments. This was an increasing source of peace and enjoyment to him. It was while taking his horses out for an overnight camping trip that he accidentally stumbled on a revolutionary total fitness approach, which he dubbed power walking.
What you do is you take the longest stride as possible, standing very erect, and you swing your arms in the pendulum motion, and you breathe in for 3 steps and out for 3. It sounds very technical, but it's not really. That's good. Push off of your heels now. That's good.
Reeves wrote about his new fitness method and even published a book on it. However, tragedy struck the Reeves household in August of 1989, when Aline, his beloved wife of 26 years, suffered a stroke and died shortly thereafter. Reeves grieved quietly but deeply. He continued to exercise, ride his horses, and do what he could to get through life without his beloved Aline. The accolades continued to pour in. It was revealed that among his most ardent admirers were Winston Churchill, James Dean, and J. Paul Getty. Actors, entertainers, and athletes such as Burt Reynolds, Sylvester Stallone, Willie Mays, Gordie Howe, Wayne Newton, and Bo Derek all paid him tribute. He received awards from the United States Marine Corps, the President's Council on Physical Fitness, and the Downtown Athletic Club of New York City, the company which annually sponsors the prestigious Heisman Trophy Award. They even went so far as to create a special Steve Reeves Award for the individual who has made notable contributions to fitness and sports during his or her lifetime. Even Dr. Evard Fairbanks, a Guggenheim Fellow and one of the world's leading art figures, known as the world's greatest sculptor of President Lincoln, as well as the Pony Express Monument, said, "Steve Reeves is the epitome of a man bringing his physique into harmony with the universe he is a part of. He is the grandest example I have ever seen of Michelangelo's dream come true." His personal life took a turn for the better when, in the mid-1990s, he met pretty Deborah Engelhorn, who became his friend and later his life partner for the remainder of his days.
Ladies and gentlemen, I bring to you the myth, the legend, Hercules Reeves!
Suddenly, bodybuilding rediscovered him. They couldn't believe, in a day and age when steroid use was rampant, that a human being could build his body up to such magnificent proportions naturally. He was sought after as a popular advocate of natural bodybuilding, explaining to his growing legion of fans that the introduction of steroids into the sport was ruinous to both the health of the bodybuilder and to the longevity of the sport. When asked during a television interview how he felt he stacked up to the current crop of steroid-laden bodybuilders, he replied,
"I think I'm the greatest." No, you see, I always strive for proportion. See, these guys today, they take steroids and things like that, and that's very bad for your liver and your pancreas and things like that. No, I don't believe in that. I believe if a man doesn't have enough male hormones within himself to build his body, he should take up something like ping pong.
Well, I mean, I think it's a terrible thing because actually bodybuilding should be a health-oriented sport instead of a drug-oriented sport. I think it came about because people wanted to take the easy way to get there. And one guy took the easy way and started getting results. And so somebody else, well, he did it, I'll do it. And it went back and forth. And the magazines, instead of discouraging it, were encouraging it.
With such a resurgent interest in Reeves' training principles and career, nobody could have anticipated that fate would step in and claim his life. It happened on May 1st, 2000, when, at the age of 74, Steve Reeves died as a result of a freak blood clot that had worked its way to his brain after a minor surgical procedure. The bodybuilding world turned out en masse to honor the passing of its first and greatest legend, while fans of his heroic films wrote thousands of letters praising his inspirational performances. What set him apart was that while other bodybuilders struggled to become famous, he was content being Steve Reeves. That was enough to bring him worldwide fame and legendary status. From his successes on the bodybuilding stages of the world, to his bravery under fire in the foxholes of the Second World War, to the pulling down of temples with his bare hands in films, Steve Reeves' life was no less heroic than his movies. He was a man's man who lived life by his own terms from beginning to end. To such an artist of life, death can only claim the bones. The spirit lives on.
I would never play the villain type role. My audience thought of me as a hero. I thought of myself as a hero. That's why I wanted to represent myself. And that's the way it went.